much you've been doing this for decades, pretty much since you were a child. And
yeah, that's basically what I, yeah. I guess it's a way for me to get positive attention. That's probably how, in my, you know, reflecting back, that's basically why I do it, is because it's positive attention. Because I did a lot of stuff that wasn't positive, but this is, I think, you know.
So I was thinking maybe we could go back and talk about the beginnings of schools, libraries. I mean, it looks like you've done the entire state, probably outside as well.
Hardly, but yeah, I'm pretty diverse. That's my personality also, you know, dyslexic and attention deficit and things like this. It's my negative and positive that I have a hard time focusing. And I think I would be so farther along stability-wise in life if I could focus on one thing. And probably as I age, I've thought about this, I will have to do less things. Like a lot of them are very physical, like doing outside murals, especially you're dealing with the weather. Well, a lot of things I do, I mean, plein air is the same way. And so is street painting. But then you're also climbing scaffold and just, you know, lifting heavy things. And so I know in time that's just going to get, be less effective for me. And the same thing with street painting, because that's like extreme yoga. You're down there on the ground and you can't move when the weather's bad. So those things, like when I was in my late 20s doing street paintings, you know, I'd hop up and look at it many times. And now I just sit there and I work on it for a long time. And then it's like, okay, I get up and then I go, okay, there's about 15 things I need to change. And then I get back down on the ground and I fix those. So that's how that. So anyway, I'm just rambling about how difficult things can be. And that's going to limit what I can do. And maybe I'll get better at it. I mean, I'll probably end up doing more studio stuff and probably just plein air, unless I do group things.
I was just thinking maybe we could go back to the beginnings.
Okay.
How did you discover art? And how did you know that that was for you?
Oh, okay. The beginnings, like I said, it was a way for me to get positive attention. I have an older brother who's very smart, and my sister is younger, but our father was quite intense person. So, a personality. So it was hard to get a word in. And then I had my own issues with dyslexia and stuff like this. So I really had a hard time getting attention, I guess. And I'm thinking, why would I do this? And of course, teachers young in elementary school would, I'd get praised for certain things, you know, and I assume, and looking back, probably everybody did. But for me, I guess it was like, this is something I can do that I can get a positive read on it. So that's probably the first steps. And then in high school, being an introvert type character it's a great way to get attention once again without actually interacting face to face with somebody.
So at first you started drawing, doing sketches or figures or action heroes?
I doodled, but they were pretty well just abstract shapes and lines and nothing that really makes any sense. I mean, a lot of my friends would do would do exactly what you just said, were cars or superheroes or mushrooms or horses, you know, whatever they were into. For me, it was more about, I don't know, I just would always be just doing things in the corner of the paper or whatever, just drawing the shapes and line work and stuff. And
then you found that this was a way to express yourself.
Yes. I mean, I decided I would try this. I mean, I'm trying to think, I don't want to jump ahead or anything, but yeah, so I'm in high school and my parents are both in the military. And then I was also in the Army Guard. And so I thought, well, I'll go that route. But then my brother, I think my brother was an influence on saying, you should just keep trying to do this art. And I ended up going to college, which probably wasn't a great fit for me because I had to take all these developmental classes. But I did graduate, and my major was art, and my minor is technical theater, doing backdrops and things like that. So I decided to pursue it at that point. Yeah.
If you come from a military family, did you live on base, military bases?
Yes. Yeah. We lived all over. Like I was born in New Jersey, Fort Dix, New Jersey, but we lived there maybe 3 or 4 years. And then we lived in different places. Overseas, we were in Okinawa, the Ryukyu Islands off of Japan. And then we moved back. But I think I was 10 when they retired. And we moved to where we live now, the Southeast Missouri, which seemed like an odd place to move. But my mom had one of her sisters lived here. So she wanted to be close to some family, and they all, my mom was from Chicago area. My dad's from New England, Vermont. So, and then they had relatives. So it was a good location to go out and see other, to visit other people and our, relations. So that's basically why I think we ended up here. And then I was, I basically went to Kansas City and St. Louis, which are both in Missouri. And so I'm still here. I can't believe it. But I do get around some, different jobs get me out and about. I just got back from Minnesota.
From drawing, how did you get into print art?
Well, I being isolated out here in the Midwest, at least that's how it felt back then. I think we all saw Mary Poppins, so Bert, the character, Dick Van Dyke's character, Bert, he was a street screever. One of his many jobs jobs he did was, in England they call it street screeving, but it's street painters. So he did those. They pop into the image and all that. So that's the first time I saw it. And then I saw it, I think on 60 Minutes, they did a deal. Or it was on the national news, and they were over in Europe showing people, and that was one of the things they were showing. So I thought that was interesting. So the town I live in here, Cape Girardeau, Missouri, this is 35 years ago. They would have a festival, and they had a working artist thing. So I thought, well, let me just try this. It looked really interesting. And it was it wasn't interactive, but you could see what was going on. So that's where I went from there. And it was very popular, and I just kept getting jobs from that. That's where the street painting came from. Yeah. And also my minor is technical theater, and, you lay the classic way, or one of the ways of laying out street painting is just like laying out a backdrop. You grid it off, like we probably all did in school, one little square on the rendering equals a large square on the ground. So that's basically how I started.
You're doing 2D and 3D. Which one is more challenging? I'm assuming 3D.
The 3D street painting?
Yes,
I think that. Because if you don't get it right, it just doesn't work. And there's only one location that the viewer can be in for it to look properly. So yeah, you have to do that. And you can work it all up on computer, which is great. And most of the time it works out pretty well. But every side is different, the curve and shape of the ground. So when you get there, you're still making corrections. And then you're dealing with the elements. The hard part about doing a two-dimensional street painting, especially if you're doing a master's, the classic way is to do a master's art, a master's piece. But you really, in the United States especially, you don't see a whole lot of people doing that anymore. They're doing their own thing, which is cool too. But the original way is to do a master's. So then you got to be accurate to their vision, So the hard part about it is making sure you know, the Mona Lisa looks like the Mona Lisa, or whatever image you're doing. And it's also cool because you get to basically hang out with the artist that you pick, you know, that masters, whoever you do, you know, George O'Keefe or Hopper or whoever, or some European master. So, you know, that's kind of cool. You get to develop their piece. And in my mind, anyway, I'm thinking, you know, you start to imagine what they were thinking and how they're going about things, and maybe learning their personality a little bit. That's the 2D side.
And you've done murals at banks, libraries, schools.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, just whatever comes up. I'm not the best marketer, but so, you know, somebody gets a hold of me. And right now I'm probably getting more, I'm on Instagram more than anything. If you look on there, you'll see it's CRTART. But I've done a couple of postcard murals, which are, you know, you've seen them 100 times probably. It's the name of the town you're in. And maybe the state in the United States, that's how it would be. And then inside each letter, there's an event or a landmark of that area. So I've just finished one this winter in Vicksburg, Mississippi. And I did one here where I live that's twice the size in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. But those are real popular because they're, you know, visitors will come up on those, the touring boats, you know, like the Viking ships or whatever, and you can just imagine they wake up, where am I today? And then there's this huge sign that says, you know, basically says, welcome to where you are, you know. You know where you are then. But I don't know, I mean, different groups, like there's a group just like I said, came back from Minnesota, and we're working on this large candy store, and each room has a different theme. And the theme I just came back from was space. So we did a variety of space themes and stuff inside of it. I'm pretty diverse. And like last fall, I got hooked up with a laser tag group. So all we did was go in and we worked over they built a marina, and then we distressed it like it was a torn up building or something. I don't know.
I also noticed that you've done very large murals on buildings.
Yep, I've worked with Tom Alvin out of Chicago on some large structures. Let's see, in Chicago, some of those buildings, one was like 22 stories high. We did 3 sides of it. So we used a swing stage like window washers use, you know, and they would go up, you know, every story, and we'd do it that way. It's very beautiful outside like that. But that's fun to do. I don't have a problem with heights. If you have a problem with heights, then it's not for you. But but it's fun to do those too. And then of course nowadays articulating booms are very popular. I mean, they've really there's a lot more of them, and they're a lot more agile, so those are other routes that you'll see more artists using those nowadays. And you can also do a whole mural by yourself, you know, on this massive scale, so that's kind of cool.
You are painting in the studio and also outside. You're doing plein air.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, I got a few behind me, actually. These are some, oops, sorry. Those are some of my older ones, which I enjoy. I just kept those. Plein air is a great thing, and I really haven't been doing that. Well, I guess maybe about 18 years or so. But that was nice because I come from a background that doesn't, I have one uncle who was a Sunday painter, but other than that, there was no people who did art in my family's. So So everything was really tight and try to be accurate as a photo. And then the plein air really loosened me up a lot. And, you know, and it's more, you know, I really like that feeling. It's probably more my personality also, being more relaxed and stuff. So I really enjoy doing plein air. Mm-hmm. I try to, well, this year I'm going to cut back just because I got too many local jobs I got to knock out. But like last year, I probably did four or five different plein air events around. So I try to do some of them every year too.
Let's talk a little bit about your pastels and your chalk art.
Okay. Well, actually, the dog just came in. It's pretty, I almost don't, I mean, I do some drawings. There's a dog right there of, mainly I use street paint, pastels on street paintings, but I do occasionally do I'm looking around here. I don't have any in this room. Occasionally I'll do a pastel, just like a fine art piece, a portrait or something like that. And I've done a couple in this last year, but really I just use it for street painting. I mean, there was a time I just got really into it, and I was making my own pastels and things like this. And that just, you know, it's like, what am I doing? Because, you know, all that, it costs a lot, and it's very interesting and cool, and the pastels last longer. Yeah, it's like, okay, I did enough of that. But yeah, but basically just street painting.
I looked at your themes, and dancers show up. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like the figure. I think the figure is probably the most challenging thing, because we all know, you know, we all look at each other all the time and such like that, and dancers especially just sort of show a lot of movement, and I think that, and just that really is intriguing, I think. So, and just a real challenge. So I really like to do those too.
And you're inspired by celebrities, actors such as Vincent Price, pin-up girls, arts from the 50s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little of everything. The Vincent Price one was a river wall a mural that was those. Let me see. I think it was Betty Grable was the other one. Anyway, they were the theme was a Missouri Wall of Fame of Missouri. So these people either were from Missouri or moved to Missouri. So like you talked about those two characters, they're from Missouri. So anyway, that's why I painted those two.
You are running a drawing group.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the drawing group I'm working on this drawing group we just had last night. It's been going on since 1979. My professor Grant Lund started it, and then of course he retired, and then I took it over in the late 90s or somewhere in that time period, and it still goes on. So it's funny. I mean, it's pretty right now. Especially since the pandemic, the numbers have been down a lot. But we used to. It was hard to tell how many people would come because it'd been going on so long. And sometimes there'd be six or eight, and then another week, the 20 people would show up. So it was kind of hard to gauge. But it's very important. I think once again, I think the figure is. The more difficult image things to work with. So this way, once a week, if I'm not working out of town or something, I'm get a chance to keep working with it. And so that's something I hope I always get to do, because it's just great exercise for drawing.
Your palette varies in your acrylics. You're using a certain palette, but in your pastels, the palette changes, and in your murals, completely changed.
Yeah. My wife says I have multiple personalities, so maybe that's showing up. I mean, of course, you want to work as an artist. You want to, it's best to, whatever medium you're using, you should accept or whatever, or work with the medium and media and not against it. You know, that's basically why maybe they're different looking. I'm trying to just work the best way I think it works for me and the medium. So they do vary a little bit, yeah. And then airbrushing, of course, a totally different thing, which I don't think I have any examples of. But that's where I met my wife. We both worked at an amusement park, and we both airbrushed. But, yeah, that's something I don't do much now.
Do you mixed media?
Every once in a while. I mean, you know, I'll start off with maybe graphite or new pastel or something like this, and then work it up into some kind of a liquid form, watercolor underneath, and then acrylic. And I've done acrylic plain air, and then I've put oil on top of it, you know, because you get different feels and effects sometimes, or you just can't get it. Sometimes acrylics like to lay flat, and then you can just hit it with oil on top of it, and that really resonates a lot. I think most plain air artists are oil painters, and acrylics have come a long way, and I think, you know, oil is a classic way to do it, and there's a central feel to oils, and I think that still resonates, you know, especially when you're outside and it's raining. Oils hold up a little longer than acrylics in the rain.
What about pets? You have a dog. Do you do pets?
Occasionally, yeah. I've done some pets before. I actually put this dog in Mural. My wife's an art teacher, and the school she was at the time, I was doing a large mural, so he's in one of the parade scenes there. He's walking around here, but so yeah, occasionally I'll do one. It just depends what people like just go from one job to another a lot of times, just whatever somebody, and most people, the average public, you know, they don't, I don't know how close, I mean, I guess it's like any field, you just don't know what it's about unless you're in it, but they think every artist can do everything, and so they all try it, you know, or somebody will come up to you not thinking, well, this person only does like still lives, and they ask you to do a dog or something, and it's like some artists are just like really set in what they want to do. And I try to scale back on doing everything. But, you know, if I think I can knock it out and do a good job of it, I'll go ahead and still take it, you know, still take that job. So, yeah, so I still do. I don't know if that makes sense. Animals.
Do you teach online as well?
No, I don't. I mean, every once in a while I'll do a workshop, you know, just because it's hard for me to, I don't teach online because I'm not squared away to do that. Yeah, like workshops, mainly it's hard for me to like just teach lessons because I'll go out of town, you know, and it'll screw up the whole schedule. So, but if I know I'm only going to be teaching a workshop for a weekend or maybe a week, then I can schedule that and then that'll work out, and I'll just do that. And I've done them in, you know, street painting, plein air, and figurative are the three main areas. And I even did a mural class a couple times, I guess. But, yeah, my wife is more about teaching, you know. She's really good at that also.
You've done arts for 4 decades?
Yeah, I guess. Well, I mean, I graduated when I graduated, 1985, and then we had children, we got married early on, and I did a lot of jobs that were not art oriented, it took a long time for me to get to that point where I could just do art, and it's still, you know, struggle sometimes, and that's probably been 25 years, probably been doing it full time.
How would you say that arts evolved throughout this time?
Throughout the times since I've been alive?
Yeah.
It seems a lot less structured. I mean, there's still schools out there, or, you know, pockets of things, you know, you're always going to have your fine art, your classic art, you know, the realistic art and your impressionistic. And do I feel like, I mean, of course, computer is probably the biggest thing, you know, I mean, so that's another type of art that you can do. And saying that, a lot of schools are more design oriented now than doing the classic teachings. And that's one of the things I was talking about, the figure drawing group. I think maybe one of the reasons the numbers are lower in those classes are because our local university here, it does have a drawing class and all, but I don't believe that it, because I went to the same school, they do as much classic teaching there. I mean, there's a lot more computer art classes and so design oriented classes, and which makes sense because that's where the jobs are, right? I mean, so I don't think there's as much emphasis, or, you know, people just don't have the time as much to do that. That's probably the biggest change, I think, that I can think of.
I've seen a few paintings of yours with, for example, with the American flag, some, you know, details of a building. Are you?
Oh, okay. I mean, yeah, I do it, but maybe that's more of a streetscape or something, like plein air or part of a mural, something like this. My wife, again, she does like pen and ink, like renderings of structures or buildings or homes. So there's, this dog is getting up in my, but, he's not a lap dog, but he just wants attention, I think. But anyway, my wife is probably more the person who does that kind of stuff.
Are you doing pen and ink?
I've done pen and ink. Do I do it a lot? I mean, when I do, back to the figure drawing group, I'll finish a tablet. I don't have one within reach here, but you know, I'll go through a sketchbook, and when I get to the done, I'll change mediums. Like I'll do, like right now I'm doing watercolor. I'll do a watercolor of the figure, whether it's a portrait or the full figure. And then when I'm done with that book, a lot of times I'll just switch. Like I might do pen and ink or color pencil or just ballpoint pen. I'll just do a whole thing in that, or the warm ups in that. But pen and ink, I mean, unless somebody specifically wants one, I don't usually do that. Or if I'm out and about and I forgot my materials, there's a pen, and then I use it, that kind of thing.
You're doing a lot of realistic painting. Have you also done abstract?
I've done some abstract. I'm trying to think. I just did one recently. Normally, like an abstract within a mural and things like this, it's not really what I'm shooting for. I enjoy doing it. Like I said, I came from a background that you know, it was all about looking like an image. Or, I don't know. Yeah. So I do a little bit of that, but I usually want something to trigger off of, or you know, to jump off of. So usually that's something that's recognizable or something to an individual.
I wanted to ask you about the tool that you're using. You're using brushes, palette knives, other tools?
Tools, I use a lot of brushes, I think. I mean, of course, I probably paint. I'm trying to think, I paint more than anything, or draw, you know. So the tools I use, I don't have any specific tools of mine, like brushes. I abuse my tools, so it doesn't really matter too much because I can get a really nice brush. Although, and still abuse it. But I was going to say, I used to retouch photographs a long time ago before the computer and all. So that was interesting. And then those were like Robert Simmons double aughts and triple aughts. They were really small brushes working on the negative of the photograph. And those, I took really good care of those. And but other than that, I'm thinking of different brushes. There's a brand that I like that's just a house painter's quality brush. And of course, the surface I'm working on, whether it's a stiff or a soft or semi-soft brush, those are things I think about. And then, of course, in drawing, and you got your drafting kind of pencils. So whether I need a hard to start off with, or the light line, or there's a softer later on to really lay it down more. This is the kind of things I think about with tools.
Painting on different surfaces, walls, canvas, different surfaces. And each surface, is some of them are easier to paint on, others are harder.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, especially outside murals. I mean, where was I? In Cleveland, we were painting a mural, and this group of us, and the tuck pointing was so bad on the bricks. It was like we were tuck pointing with paint. We were just jabbing gobs of paint in the holes of the wall and all. And that was holding the bricks in almost. So that was kind of funny. I was going to mention about tools. A friend of mine who works with me, she mentioned how odd it was that that I would take a piece of cardboard. She used to call it a janky piece of cardboard, and it's all messed up. But I would use it for like a scale, or a repeated pattern, or I would get I'd make a big triangle if I was trying to get a certain angle that I had to repeat. So cardboard comes in real handy. That's a tool that a lot of people, I've seen people use also, and outside it's a great tool, but it's not very fancy, but it works real well.
Have you been invited to teach abroad?
No, not really. No, my wife and I went over to Graz, Italy, and did the street painting festival there. But we haven't taught abroad or anything.
Missouri is very rich in history and arts, and you have so many influences there in Missouri.
There's a couple. A couple I think of. George Caleb Bingham. He did some early. I would almost call it early regional, but of course Thomas Hart Benton was a regionalist in his style, and I really I think George Caleb Bingham was more of documenting, and he had a nice feel to his pieces also, but I really liked Thomas Hart Benton's. I like his movement, I like his colors, and I like his figurative gestural, just lots of movement to him, and emotion almost. This dog is acting weird. Sorry.
About your dancers, how do you decide what pose are you going to paint? Because some of the poses that you use, the poses of the dancers, are you taking pictures?
Yeah, like most of those like paintings are either from a photo or probably from photos. Because depending, I mean, some of them, especially like the larger ones that are multiple canvases, those are like the goal there was to like get a movement between canvases, but they're all unified with that movement and composition overall. Hopefully the idea was to, like, each canvas would hold its own composition, but they'd also work as an overall composition, you know, and the movement along with them. That's those kind of things. But a lot of times, sometimes they're a la prima, you know, right on the spot. It just depends. Yeah.
What are you working on right now?
Well, right now, a mural in town here got tagged with graffiti. So I'm going to go after this. I'm going to go down there and take care of it. My daughter and her friends cleaned it off while I was out of town. But it still has some residue and all, so I need to just touch that up. Usually murals don't get tagged unless it's a political figure or something like that. I mean, there was one in Chicago that got hit right before we finished it, so we just touched it right back up. But most of the time, people will respect a mural and leave it alone. But unless it's like in a graffiti type environment where you do a piece and people will leave it, if they really like it, they leave it alone, you know. But most of the time they're just covering up each other's work, you know. But yeah, the next thing I'm doing is that. And then I have, I'm going to restore an old Coca-Cola sign in town, which is, I think it's 47 feet in the air. And it's got 3 cents and 5 cents a bottle, so that gives you an idea how old the sign is. You know, I don't know what they are now, dollar, $2 at least.
Have you thought of doing a book?
I have, not like a coffee table book, you know, where they sit there and look at the images. I mean, I don't know, that might be interesting. But more about the environment of what happens in these different disciplines. Each area. I mean, some of them overlap with the same ideas or things that happen to you. But they'd probably be a little whimsical. Being my personality, I think it's not going to be about all technical aspect of it, but more about what actually happens in that environment. Maybe not just from the artist's point of view, but probably majority like that. It's funny you brought that up. Yeah, I've been thinking about that for about 5 years, and it'd be fun to do those.
You told me that you're collaborating with your wife. Are you still collaborating? Are you doing anything with her right now?
Did I say collaborating with her? I think she might disagree with that. We tried to. There are couples, art couples, that work well together. I don't think that's us, and I think she'd agree. But yeah. But she's very good, and she does. Like I said, she does a lot of assemblages, and I don't know, like, you know what a Rolodex is, and before computers, she'll get one of those and. She'll, every one of those little file cards, she'll make a piece of art. So then you can roll through it and look at them all. And a lot of them are assemblages or collage type things. And she's also done a lot of boxes, I don't want to say shadow boxes, but you have basically maybe a shadow box. And then within those boxes, she's put different types of artwork and artifacts, and they all kind of relate together usually. So those are kind of cool too.
Do anything with the theater?
Well, the theater. I've worked. I worked in a scene shop in Kansas City 100 years ago. That was great. The local theater here at the university scheduled to help them do scene painting. Probably this next couple of weeks, I should go in there and do it. They scheduled me to, you know, they give me some time to help them. With whatever they're doing, because they don't have a scene painter right now, so I'm glad to do it. I mean, for Well, I'm trying to think of just the philosophy of art for me. You know, it's a lifestyle. My parents, I remember my parents really didn't like what they were doing later on in life, especially. So I guess as a teenager, it was like, I might as well try this art thing. You know, I mean, I like doing it. So that's kind of where where I come from and why I do art, you know. It makes me feel good, you know, even when I do a terrible piece of art. I'm so glad I did. Glad I went through that process, because it's a learning experience also. And you just, you know, it's as my life leaves my body, I'll be glad I did it. So there are many days I question why I'm doing it, but I'll be happy. I think, I mean, the average day I'm happy about it. Yeah.